What's up guys, welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to be watching some horrible Doom review and then criticizing the hell out of it for having stupid points. This video idea got recommended to me by Cyrus Gaming on my Discord server, and he's also got a YouTube channel. Go ahead and show him some love there. Without any further interruptions, let's just get into the video before I waste any more of your time.
The long-awaited sequel Doom Eternal hit digital shelves amid a pandemic. That was about a year ago from now, if you're wondering. Critical and fan response to Doom Eternal was exceedingly positive, and I can very much understand where everyone is coming from. However, I don't really like Doom Eternal. I think it's a fine enough game, but if given the choice between playing 2016 or Eternal, I'd pick the former every time. And here's why. Full disclosure, I've reviewed Eternal in the past, so if you'd like to watch that video first to get a rundown of the basics of Doom-style games, that's linked above and below.
Full disclosure, I don't give a shit about your other video. I'm here to watch this video. Also, you can just immediately tell he likes 2016 more, since he's pretty much playing Eternal like it's 2016. I don't like to judge people based on how they're playing Doom Eternal, but if you're gonna be calling a game bad, at least play it how it's supposed to be played.
While blasting your way through complexes full of demons from hell itself. Upon dealing enough damage to demons, they'll glow blue or orange, indicating they can be glory killed. This is done by melee bashing the enemy to deal a lethal blow, with the animation modified by the enemy type, what angle you're approaching from, and the terrain upon which you're bashing. I'm not personally a fan of glory kills, at least not the frequency of which they're expected of you.
Yeah, you're not actually expected to glory kill at all. The only time I ever glory kill is to get out of taking massive damage, or to replenish health in the occasional moment that I end up getting low. Other than that, I usually just mastery meat hook into an SSG shot for armor replenishing. If you don't want a glory kill, just don't glory kill.
Speaking of, Doom 2016's roster of weaponry is mostly maintained in Eternal, with some new ones to boot, but missing is the infinite ammo pistol, used as a last resort when your supplies run dry. In lieu of this, the chainsaw, when used on foes in Doom Eternal, will spawn copious pools of ammo in a rainbow spray. Frankly though, this system feels excessive. In 2016, the chainsaw was simply a get-out-of-fight-free card. Depending on your fuel levels, you could use it to chop down all but bosses to bypass combat with them altogether, useful for when you're low on health or supplies. In Eternal, the chainsaw with its slowly regenerating gasoline sees more use to supplement an artificial lack of ammo. Weapons' ammo supplies are noticeably lower in Eternal, and drops seem fewer and farther between. This effectively forces you to chop up a lightweight enemy every once in a while, and to compensate for this, basic enemies seem to infinitely spawn in areas you've long since cleared to serve as ammo caches. The gameplay loop of ranged combat to chainsaw to ranged combat isn't necessarily bad, but it feels more railroaded than 2016's freeform fights. The chainsaw feels necessary rather than being a fun option.
Okay, one. There's a reason the chainsaw is no longer a get-out-of-fight-free card. This now exists. Also, you're literally complaining about one of the simplest mechanics of the game. Doom Eternal has a lower ammo count to add challenge and strategy to what would have been yet another mindless shooter. The reason the chainsaw has become such a loot grenade is because of how Doom Eternal is generally supposed to be played. Forcing players to run around and find ammo on the ground in Eternal would never work, and so they gave players a much more strategic method to retaining your ammo count.
But the blood punch can bash foes to bits. Every time you get a glory kill, your blood punch will charge, and when it's fully charged, striking enemies with melee will enact a powerful swing in a radius, dealing massive damage and knocking armor off of certain kinds of demons. I enjoy blood punch overall, however, in contrast, the normal melee attack does literally no damage. It slightly staggers enemies backwards, but unlike 2016, you can't resort to swinging away when pressured. What I'm trying to say is the gameplay mechanics of Doom Eternal all feel as though they were developed independent of one another, with no consideration as to their interactions with one another.
Melee attacks have been toned down in Eternal because they want you to primarily utilize guns. It's also meant to make way for the blood punch mechanic. Besides, when are you even gonna get a valid opportunity to use a normal punch in Eternal? The game is simply too fast-paced for such a petty mechanic like that, and it would be entirely pointless. Blood Punch was a perfect addition because it had to be charged, and it's also something you can swoop in and use with ease before making a quick escape. At this point, I'm starting to think you're not comparing the two games, but rather fanboying 2016.
Platforming off the beaten path to find secret extra lives and collectibles is encouraged, yet invisible walls and kill triggers are placed in otherwise innocuous positions. Those last two connect to one another quite well, by the way, as plenty of times tutorials or cutscenes would pop up in the middle of platforming, and during the time the screen takes to fade back into gameplay, the game is still going.
I like how you're complaining about Doom Eternal not letting you go places you want to go, yet in this clip you pretty much just classified yourself as an idiot. Why would you try to jump over the wall when the indicator marker thingy is clearly showing that in order to progress through the level, you have to hit the button? It seems like you're trying to make things up at this point to make the game look bad.
Giving the player more options for exploration and combat sounds good in theory, but in practice, the game is weighed down by them. I mean, the number of abilities on the HUD bound to different keys across the keyboard, it's like playing an MMO with the Marathon Man pace of, well, Doom. Some mechanics are outright competing with each other in their intended purpose. The chainsaw and crucible, the sword that is, could absolutely have been combined together into one weapon bound to one key. They serve the same theoretical function of quickly eliminating a close range target to save on ammo. Having two instant kill melee weapons with different fuel sources is excessive and confused.
Notice how you're the only one complaining about these two? They're not excessive, they're not confusing. They're also not the same thing, since they literally both serve completely different purposes. The chainsaw's meant to replenish ammo. It is not meant to be a weapon of mass destruction. Same with the crucible sword. It's supposed to be a get-out-of-jail-free card, like the chainsaw was in 2016, and it does not replenish ammo. They're not the same.
There are new Arc-Viles, summoner-type enemies, who will spawn powered-up versions of demons who maintain their power until the summoner is killed. However, there is also the Buff Totem, which will continuously spawn and power up demons until destroyed. Why are these two separate mechanics? The fact that the game has to clarify with a pop-up when there's a Buff Totem nearby goes to show how similar and thus unnecessary having both of these features is.
Because the Archvile is an enemy that the game makes you prioritize. The buffed enemies caused by the Archvile is punishment for not giving him attention, which basically shows that you have no idea how to prioritize in a game all about prioritization. If you're complaining about the Archvile always buffing enemies, you're clearly not focusing on him properly. The Buff Totem is something to give a player a kick in the ass right off the bat. It's not counting as punishment to the player, it's literally a challenge to make the arena tougher.
And that's not even getting into the new Empowered Demons feature added after launch. This will randomly power up demons who have killed other players during their own campaigns and drop more supplies as a reward upon being defeated. While I don't hate this conceptually, the fact that it effectively randomly buffs enemies means any difficulty balance this feature could supply has gone out the window.
You know you can just turn off Empowered Demons, right? Empowered Demons spice up gameplay and throw something at you that you don't expect. It just adds to the game, and if you don't like it, disable it. Easy.
Speaking of the campaign, as I mentioned, I don't much care for the story of the Doom games, so I enjoy the ability to skip cutscenes, which was quite lacking in 2016. I can just enjoy the ride without asking why. However, the plot of Eternal is far less secondary as compared to 2016's, meaning that while cutscenes can be skipped, it feels weird to do so? There was clearly some thought put into this narrative as much as I dislike it, but during the cutscenes I did watch, it's clear the Doom guy also doesn't care about the story. All around him, there's this creepy messiahification of him, which is really not pleasant to watch. It's not enjoyable nor interesting, just gross in my opinion.
You know there's people in the Doom community who like the story, right? People who generally enjoy some narrative and lore to the games they play? I'll admit, I don't care about the story either. But the whole reason the skip cutscene button is there is to satisfy the people who don't care about Doom's story, though. If you're not looking at Doom for every aspect it has, then you shouldn't be doing a review on it. A game review is meant to look over everything, not just pick and choose what you want whilst ignoring the rest. By doing what you're doing, you're pretty much making Doom Eternal look like a bad game, You're only listing off the things you don't like about it, while ignoring the things that you do like about it.
The rune system makes a return from 2016, equipable unlocks which augment your abilities, such as more air control, faster glory kills, etc. There are also praetor tokens, which augment your abilities, such as faster equipment cooldown, more quickly platforming, etc. There are also crystals, which increase your HP, ammo, and armor, and augment your abilities, such as faster flamethrower cooldown, more health on glory kills, etc. There are also weapon mods, which augment your abilities, and have their own two currencies, which further- Okay, this could have all been one fucking system. Combine together the crystals, weapon points, suit tokens, mastery tokens, runes, all of it. Combine it all into one system of currency to purchase upgrades, or at least a smaller number of fragmented systems like Dune 2016. The menu is confusing, unintuitive to navigate, and remembering what upgrades you've unlocked is tricky in a pinch, not to mention that spending sentinel batteries, another fucking system of currency by the way, to unlock upgrades in your home base doesn't autosave the game, meaning if you wish to upgrade everything before taking a break so you can jump right back in next time, well, you can't.
Yeah, this all has to do with the fact that you have the memory capacity of a 5-year-old. Not to mention, Doom 2016 did this exact same thing. They had the Argent Orbs, the runes, the weapon upgrades, everything was the exact same. So you can't say Doom Eternal is worse than 2016 when you're literally complaining about everything that was carried over from Doom 2016 into Eternal. It just makes no sense.
The Marauder isn't a fun enemy to fight. This guy with a shield which can only be targeted at mid-range and is immune to weapons like the BFG or insta-kill sword, you know, the weapons you'd ideally want to save for powerhouses like this, rather than use on mooks, but anyways, the Marauder instantly shields itself upon incoming damage, except for right before its attack as its eyes glow green. In theory, this idea works well, especially during a mid-campaign boss battle which uses the same mechanic to great effect. In practice, however, every Marauder encounter is filled with backstepping, trying to maintain mid-range and waiting for him to stop using attacks he can't be shot during, and instead use the one attack during which he can be hurt.
Oh my god, how did I know this was gonna pop up? It was like a time bomb waiting to explode. The reason the Marauder is so hard to use is because you're completely ignoring the mechanics you're supposed to use to take him out. The Falter Effect, manipulation of super weapons, a whole bunch of different ways to take out the Marauder with ease. You're also literally letting him kick your ass. You're not even trying to keep your distance from him, you're just right up in his face like you're about to break into a fist fight. You can't be complaining about something if you're not gonna bother trying to handle it correctly.
I'm being harsh. I personally think fairly so, but upon my second playthrough of Eternal for this video, I found myself barely caring as I played. I didn't care as much about the upgrades, the secrets, and the fast-paced combat as I did during my review.
Of course you didn't care, you were playing the game to compare to 2016, and so secrets and such weren't something you cared about. Secrets are secrets, it's not like they're going to be fun every single time you encounter them, because you already know what the secret is. So yeah, no shit you didn't find the secrets fun on your second playthrough.
Both games are lacking a bit of direction to guide the player forward.
There's literally a marker to indicate where you're supposed to progress to, but alright, whatever.
Gameplay-wise, however, 2016 simply plays better, faster, less downtime from tutorials and needless new mechanics.
This comment about faster gameplay in 2016 is so idiotic, I'm starting to wish I never even watched the video. It's causing me to lose brain cells at drastic speeds.
Let's talk about something important. What is Doom supposed to be? Obviously, when developing a game, you can make it pretty much however you want. It's your product, or id and Bethesda's in this case. But the name and ideas of Doom assume a certain style of play. To me, Doom is fast-paced combat in a series of arenas connected by hallways with secrets off the beaten path. Demons and bloodshed, hell and brimstone, with a variety of firearms to spice up gameplay. Doom 2016 does all of this, in my opinion, brilliantly. On top of that, there are also unskippable cutscenes which disrupt the flow, which is a bit obnoxious. Eternal, on the other hand, does all of these things very well, but in addition, there's 3D platforming, various side-grade kits, specific enemy weaknesses, and a level of difficulty that expects you to use all these mechanics in tandem without actually offering any particularly fun. fun methods to do so. It's the same game as 2016 with a bunch of needless add-ons, filling up the HUD and taking up development time. I'm not saying Eternal should have been exactly the same game as 2016, I'm saying that a handful of these mechanics should have been explored further rather than barely touching on so many of them.
Actually, these new features are pretty needed. Would you rather have the same boring shooter with no additional features to enhance gameplay, or would you rather a game that has been expanded off the original features and mechanics whilst introducing new ones to shine light onto a new title? At the end, he basically just recaps everything and then says the multiplayer of the game isn't his thing. I can understand that part, actually, considering the multiplayer generally sucks. So yeah, that was probably one of the worst comparisons of a game to its predecessor that I've ever seen. It was completely based on his incapabilities of handling the slightest bit of complication, while also being unable to decide on whether he wanted the game to introduce more features or keep it the same as 2016. If you like what you saw today, make sure to leave a like on the video and maybe consider subscribing. Also, make sure to join the Discord that I've listed in the description below, because we're pretty fun down there, so yeah. That's all I've got for today, thanks for watching, and as always, stay safe.